introduce to you Dr. Leonid Perlovsky. I have to read this. There's no way I'm going to memorize it, and it's too extensive. Dr. Leonid Perlovsky is a principal research physicist and technical advisor at the Air Force Laboratory and visiting scholar at Harvard University. He leads research projects on mathematical models of the mind, cognitive algorithms, language, and cultural evolution. As a chief scientist at Nichols Research, he led the corporate research in intelligent systems. He served as a professor at Novosibirsk Engineering Institute and New York University. As a principal of commercial startups developing tools for biotechnology for financial predictions. His company predicted the stock market crash. Don't we all wish we had known Dr. Perlovsky? Oh, I've given half my portfolio, which I lost. A week before the event, detected ripples from Al-Qaeda trades, and later helped the Securities and Exchange Commission looking for perpetrators. He is invited as a keynote speaker worldwide, including most prestigious venues such as the Nobel Forum. He's published more than 465 publications, 4 books in Oxford and Springer, and received 2 patents. And in his spare time, Dr. Perlovsky participates in organizing conferences on computational intelligence, serves as the chair for the IEEE Boston Computational Intelligence Chapter, chair for the IEEE Task Force on the Mind and Brain, and on the International Neural Network Society Board of Governors as chair of the Awards Committee. He serves on the editorial board of 10 professional journals, has founded and serves as the editor-in-chief for Physics of Life Reviews. He's led the national and international awards, including the Gabor Award and the John Lucas Award, the highest U.S. Air Force award for basic research. I am humbled.
Thank you, John. So, physics of mind, or first I'll discuss what it is and if such a thing could be. And then I discuss the first principles of mind, because physics is based on first principles. This is the main idea. I discuss the first principles of mind. I then go to mathematical models of these first principles, of what can be derived from them about how the mind works. And then another part of my interest is using mathematical models of the mind to derive cognitive algorithms for solving engineering problems. And so there is a number of algorithms that we developed that solve problems that had not been solved for decades. And of course, I'm happy about that, and I'll tell you something about it. And then I'll discuss what could be done in the future, and I think the future in this direction is infinite, but I'll see if you share with me this opinion. So physics of the mind. Physics is different from other disciplines in that physics pays attention to finding first principles that describe a wide area of knowledge. These mathematical models must be making testable predictions. That's a significant part of physics. That's what Newton has done. He came up with the first principle, such as gravitation, and then predicted how moves and other planets will move. And indeed, of course, his predictions were confirmed. So using these mathematical models, we were able to explain certain things in psychology that were not understood previously, and made a number of predictions, and these predictions had been experimentally confirmed. And so I'll tell you about some of that. I hope I can conclude that, I will conclude that physics of the mind indeed is possible, because it is possible to identify few first principles based on which significant part of what mind does can be explained. And so that's kind of the main thing of what I would like to say, that first few principles can be identified, can be mathematically formulated, can explain a lot of things, and they can make predictions that could be tested and had been some of them tested in the lab. So let me start with these first principles, at least some of them. First principles include instincts, emotions, and concepts, and the hierarchy. So, and I will say a few more words about how they operate, what are these first principles, how they operate, or at least what are their mathematical models of how they operate, and how it is implemented in the brain. I will at least touch on that. When talking about hierarchy, it is important to mention bottom-up and top-down principle signals, because that is one of the fundamental way of how the mind operates. One of the first principles, there are signals coming, let's say, from retina, so to speak, up, and then there are signals coming from our memories down, and they interact, and this is how we understand the world. This is how perception works, this is how cognition works. Then I'll touch on higher emotions and cognitions, and the basic principles that are important to understand higher cognitions, something that is specifically human and which we don't share with animals. Well, actually, the knowledge instinct, it acts throughout the entire hierarchy of the mind, and at the bottom, it is similar for humans and for animals. But higher up, there are abstract concepts, and it is possible to understand what is beautiful. And so that's what I like very much, that the beautiful is a very specific thing, and it is possible to understand what it is. It is not, as I will say in more details later, you can say that kind of this is beautiful. So how is it possible that on one hand everybody is sure that something like beautiful exists? On the other hand, you never can agree, you cannot expect that other people will agree with you that what you say is beautiful, they also will say that it is beautiful. So I will go over how is it possible to reconcile this fundamental property of the beautiful. These few principles that I listed here, they describe a lot. There are a few more that we know about and that I kind of yet left outside of discussion, and I came to them later. So first, concepts. Concepts is not the most simple mechanism in the mind, but it is the most easy for us to discuss because we consciously operate with them. That's the reason I start with concepts. Concepts, or in other ways, neural representations, or in other ways, there are memories. That is something that we have seen, we remember, it is in our mind, and they are neurally represented there. And from a mathematical standpoint, it is like models. Like, for example, there is a concept of chair in my mind, and it literally, its representations can be mathematically modeled as a mathematical model of a chair. How is it possible that the mathematical model of a chair is good enough to recognize chairs that you had never seen in your life? For example, this particular shape with this particular color you may never have seen previously, but you will recognize that it is a chair. And I will dwell on that. That is, of course, a fundamental thing. Actually, the reason it is possible to do mathematically can be modeled with dynamic logic. Dynamic logic is one of the fundamental principles of how the mind operates. That mind is not logical. For example, this is a chair is a logical statement, but this is not how our mind brain operates. Every representation, every memory in the mind brain actually is not specific for specific object, but is vague. And this is the main idea of dynamic logic. It describes processes from vague representations, plans, thoughts to crisp and specific. And this kind of overcoming, maybe a little bit later I will explain why do we think that we are thinking logically and what really happens. Maybe on the next chart I will say a few more words about it. But again, I will repeat, the dynamic logic is a process, and it is a process from a vague representation to crisp representations. And that is the reason that we can understand so many different objects that we had never seen previously. Because our memories, representations are vague, they match everything that is around. So every new object that comes, it matches to some extent our memories, because our memories are not, as we might think, specific, crisp. No, they are vague. And now let me demonstrate the first experimental proof that this is how the mind brain operate. Look at any object in front of you, then close your eyes and imagine this object with closed eyes. It could be, you know, your notepad that you're writing on, or the board, or me, or anything. And if you just please follow me, indeed do what I do, just for 5 seconds, close your eyes and try to imagine this object. And with closed eyes, your imagination is vague. Not as script. Now you can open your eyes and look again at this object, and you will see it could be this chair, for example. And I see it as a very perfectly crisp and clear object. But again, I can repeat it again. I close my mind trying to imagine it, and I cannot imagine it as crisp as I see it with opened eyes. Now, what this tells us about working of the mind, this tells us that representations, because, let me maybe make a step back. The way I repeat again, I think I said it, but let me repeat it. The way I see that it is a chair is that memories of chair in my mind match this chair, and then I understand that this is a chair. But with closed eyes, my memories are vague. And that is the reason that they could match any new kind of chair that I see. Well, actually, well, it seems when you open eyes, it seems that you see everything around right away. Well, actually, it is a long process by the standard of neural interactions in the brain. It takes about 0.6 of a second to recognize objects after you opened eyes. And this is a lot of time by number of neuronal operations. These are thousands. And more than thousands of neuronal operations, because thousands of neurons are involved, and they operate like 10 operations per second. So it is a very long time. But we are not conscious about how this happens. We are not conscious even about our memories. Maybe specific memories. We might think that we are, it seems maybe sometimes that we are conscious about it, but we are not as conscious as we are with open eyes. When you look at this thing and you see it, of course, you see it consciously. But when you close your eyes, try to imagine, your imagination, not only it is vague, it is also less conscious than your perception with open eyes. And this is a fundamental part of what brain does. Well, it was this experiment that I just described, that we just did here with closing and open eyes. It was repeated at Harvard and published in Proceedings of National Academy of Sciences. This group of people, they have demonstrated what we just discussed, that our memories, representations, are vague and also unconscious, or certainly less conscious than what we see with open eyes. So what is vague is unconscious, and we will need to return to this later. Or at least less conscious, because you can, to some extent, you can imagine, or you can kind of recollect that you, what are your imaginations with closed eyes. Even so, it is difficult, but it is possible. So it is not that we are completely and cannot be conscious about it, but not as conscious as about objects when we look at them with opened eyes. So let me say a few more words about dynamic logic, because it turns out that dynamic logic is becoming really a kind of foundation of how the mind, of mathematical way of modeling how the mind works. Yeah. First of all, let me make a step back. The last line on the previous slide. These guys have demonstrated that really the way the perception work can be adequately modeled with dynamic logic. And here's what dynamic logic is doing. Well, first of all, the reason it was invented is was because mathematical models to model mind, mathematicians working with computers were trying to create since 1950s. And many directions of mathematics toward modeling mind were invented, such as artificial intelligence, pattern recognition, neural networks, and others, and they all failed. Well, you know, computers are not as smart as even human baby, or even as not as smart even as a mouse. And why? It turned out that there is a specific mathematical reason for that, and maybe soon we will be able to overcome it to make computers smarter. But the reason was finally understood as combinatorial complexity of matching our memories to what we see with, our eyes. Hundreds, thousands of algorithms are written for pattern recognition, for artificial intelligence. They're called in many different other ways. These algorithms, if you look at them, of course, it doesn't seem so difficult to match, say, a photograph of a chair to real chair. But what turns out is that when you try to match few more objects, one object, yeah, you can kind of, you can store thousands of images of chair and try to match them to whichever, whenever you see a chair. But when there are at least even few objects, maybe a dozen of objects that you have to recognize at once, and maybe one is on top of another, and maybe there is noise and other kind of features. The algorithm looks, if you logically analyze the algorithm, it looks quite capable. No, it is the wrong word. Thousands of algorithms that looks capable of solving such an engineering problem as pattern recognition. However, in realistic, little bit more complicated situations, they don't work. And the reason they don't work is combinatorial complexity of computation. So the matching memories and sensor patterns that we see with eyes is difficult because we have to consider multiple combinations of various memories with various objects. And combinations is a bad word mathematically in the following way, that the number of combinations that you have to consider grows very fast with the number of objects. Even if you try to match, say, 100 only, you enter a room, well, there is more than 100 objects. Our mind knows how to ignore all of most of them, but computer will have to match, to try to understand, you know, everything, like patterns on the ceiling, patterns on the floor. How do we know to ignore patterns on the floor? We know that in order to understand what's going on here, only few objects are important. Say, a screen, presenter, computer, people are sitting in rows. But computer doesn't know that it should ignore what is this painting? How to know, how our mind knows that at first moment this should be ignored? Well, I will say in few minutes later how we do it, but computers don't know how to ignore this kind of things. And so computer tries to sort through combinations of everything that you can think about and what you see around. And the number of combinations is huge. And when in 1950s people who were trying to develop artificial intelligence, when they first meet with this difficulty, they thought, oh, soon computers would be faster. Well, but after a couple of decades, people realize it doesn't help. It doesn't help because the number of combinations, even for a medium complexity problem, the number of combinations requires the number of computations which is larger than all elementary particle interactions in the entire universe, in the entire time of its existence. And so better computers wouldn't help. Even if the entire universe will be working just on recognizing what is in this room, it will not have enough, will not be capable of making enough computations. Oh, yeah, probably. Yeah, certainly. Certainly.
When I'm listening to you, all I can think of is John Dewey and his idea that the whole trick to performance is to advantageously modify the objects in every encounter. And what you just described to us in a more mathematical way is that a computer can't figure out what objects in your experience are the most important and what to prioritize. But the human brain can, and it's probably trainable, right? That you can increase your ability to advantageously modify. So for example, we can either listen to all the words that you're saying as this flowing transcript, or we can abstract from that pearls, little pieces that trigger something in us that will allow us to think in a different way and behave in a different way. And what you're hoping for as a speaker is for us not to concentrate on every word you say, but instead to search for those provocations. Emerson would call them provocations.
David, perfect illustration to what I meant. Just excellent way of putting it in other words, and the difficulty was putting this kind of description into mathematics was that the way we means now everybody, including scientists, mathematicians, logical mathematicians, and illogical or whichever, is due to the fact that we are conscious only about logical states in our mind. And because of that, well, even so, in the 1930s, Gödel, many people have heard about this name, proved that logic is inconsistent and fundamentally self-contradictory. Nevertheless, when artificial intelligence guys start modeling human brain in 1950s, the only thing they knew how to do was to use logic to model the mind. But logic is only maybe 0.01% of state of what mind does. Because the reason is that we are conscious only about logical states. What is illogical in our mind brain, we are not conscious about it. So it is only with science we can assess illogical operations of the mind. But subjectively, consciously, we are conscious only about the logical states, which, yep.
But again, and I try to articulate this in my presentation, was the blockade to this sort of way of seeing is that you first have to accept the subjectivity of every experience.
Exactly.
If you think you're objectively experiencing the world, right? Me, the scientist with the white coat, we're objective. That's nonsense. That's just nonsense.
Perfect.
So when you look at your data set, there's subjectivity to that.
Absolutely.
How you interpret, how you address that.
Yep. We only see, most of the time, with rare exceptions, those things that we already know and we expect to be there. And if
my quote yesterday was from Wallace Stevens, reality is that part of reality that impresses us.
Exactly.
And really what you want to train yourself to do is to pick out those pieces of each encounter that you are impressed by, so that then it will further your work, further your progress, further your thinking, the kinds of questions that you're asking.
Excellent. Absolutely true. Let me put this in another kind of mathematical perspective, this combinatorial complexity that all algorithms faced for 70 years is, to put it another way, is like if you use Gödel's arguments, how he proved that logic is inconsistent and you apply it to a finite system. Let me make a step on the side about mathematical logicians. Gödel, as all other mathematical logicians, they operate with infinite systems and representing any number, every statement with infinite accuracy. But if you cut short this kind of like requirements and think about just complex but not infinite systems such as brain or computer, and apply Gödel's argument to a finite system, then you will not get Gödel's contradiction in logic, which is kind of absolute contradiction, but you will get combinatorial complexity. So the fact that all algorithms that people were trying to develop for the last 70 years faced combinatorial complexity, it is based on fundamental mathematical fact as is possible to be. Well, not as possible, but fundamental as mathematicians will say, tell to you is possible. Gödel's discovery is considered one of the most fundamental discovery in mathematics of the 20th century. And in order to overcome it, we have to analyze, or for reason to overcome, well, that's the difficulty why it was so difficult to overcome it. On one side, because we are only conscious about how our mind logically operates. It's difficult to imagine something else. And that's the reason why dynamic logic is at least it was difficult to come up before it. After it was discovered, it's kind of obvious. Like you close your, just do experiment that we just did. You close your eye and you see that with closed eye, you cannot imagine objects as clearly, as logically, as we see them with opened eyes. So the bottom line here is dynamic logic is a vague to crisp process which eliminates combinatorial complexity, because dynamic logic does not attempt to match all possible memories to everything that you see in front of your eyes, but just there are relatively few, of course a lot, but still relatively few things that we remember, and they match just practically any object that that occur before your eyes, because they are vague. But this vagueness and this process of matching, of going from vague to crisp, is really outside of our consciousness. So here is an example of what dynamic logic does. It's just very simple simulated mathematical example. This is the data. There are objects under the noise. That's the only thing that that computer has access to, just this thing. But I know, because I simulated this example, I know that there are objects under this noise. And we cannot even see, even when you know what to look for, you cannot see them because noise is too strong. But dynamic logic can find them. Dynamic, as I said, it starts with a vague state. And after a few iterations, the algorithm decides that, well, maybe there are three something, and at this point it thinks in terms of vague blob. And after a few more iterations, it is certain, yes, indeed, there are three of something. Then when the algorithm, so to speak, comes closer to this object, of course I'm using metaphor, mathematically word come probably doesn't belong here, but when the algorithm looks more closely in this object, it decides that no, they are not circular blobs, they are more kind of like, you know, like half moon type of objects, or like they I call them sometimes smiles and frowns. And after about 17 iterations, the algorithm stopped iterating because it cannot improve any better solution anymore. And well, what it gets here, what the algorithm gets here is pretty close to the true objects. Yeah, excellent. I'm very glad that you asked me, because I'm glad that you kind of don't let me trick you. Don't let me get away. Okay, there is a very specific reason for that, of course. What you say is absolutely right. But here, a computer does better than our visual system, because this computer algorithm was specifically developed to recognize this type of objects under white noise. But that's not how our visual system works. Our visual system was not optimized for looking under this kind of objects under the white noise. Of course, we can recognize a lot of different things, but this algorithm cannot recognize a lot of different things. It was specifically developed for few type of objects, you know, circular, you know, smiles, frowns, straight lines, but not for all kind of objects that could come up. And for this object, it works better than our mind. But you are absolutely right. That by itself is a revolutionary achievement, because before this algorithm, there had been no algorithm that could do in any situation better than human mind could do. So actually, let me just mention that in terms of signal to noise ratio, this solution is about 100 times better than previously was thought possible. And in terms of how many computations are needed for matching this object to the, in the best possible way to this image, well, it is just practically infinitely better. It will take even for this simple situations just to match in all possible ways the three objects to this picture would take about 10 power 5,000, which is much larger than the entire universe. And it was considered the unsolvable problem. But dynamic logic, as I promised, did solve it by avoiding all possible combinations. It goes from vague to specific representations. This is another example. Looks very similar, but actually it is a different kind of thing. Here are, there is a third dimension here, time. So this is X, Y, and Z. Not Z, time, I should say. And there are three objects moving across this image under noise. So this problem was considered unsolvable. There's no other algorithm that can solve it, but dynamic logic doing similar kind of operation solves it and find these moving objects. Another example, as I promised, there are what's called cognitive algorithms, algorithms that kind of models what mind does, solves engineering problem, and of course that's the reason Air Force let me do these fancy things about mind, that I could solve problems that Air Force really needed. So in this case, there is not just, there are moving objects, but in addition, well, you see there are four of them, and they are under noise, like what I have shown previously. But in this case, there are three different sensors that look at this picture, and information from all three objects is combined to decide, how many real objects are there. And so this is how dynamic logic proceeds, similar to what it did previously. But notice, even these two objects that really are on top of each other, dynamic logic separated. And the reason is that dynamic logic has access to information from three different sensors, and so all the information is put together. Again, that's kind of problem that people couldn't solve for decades. You know, this is another sensor, and you see, of course, we specifically did it in such a way that nobody will think that they can solve this problem with their algorithms, because here again, one object is on top of another, but it is a different one. And sort sensor, again, these two objects on top of each other and these two objects on top of each other. Well, it's absolutely unsolvable problem for any other algorithm, but here, by combining all the information, the dynamic logic was able to find them. Now let me show you a problem.
Maybe dynamic logic could be the way, cybernetic logic, the way you can define cybernetically things through the dynamic logic that you are thinking of.
Of course, absolutely. You're absolutely right. Yeah, it is. Yeah, that's how cybernetics should proceed. And some people working in cybernetics are familiar with my work, and that's how they proceed. This, I will explain you now what it is here. Previously, I have shown you objects under noise. These are not objects, these are situations. You can say that certain, even so it looks like noise, but it is not, well, normally what's called noise. So what is here are situations. There are 16,000 situations. Every situation contains objects shown along vertical line. For example, this situation contains object. If there is a white dot, it contains the object. And if it is black, it doesn't contain this object. And learning situation is an important problem in many areas of business and of military, important problem for military, and was not solved for decades. The difficulty with this kind of, with recognizing situation is as follows. For example, if you look in any direction, you see certain objects. Is this really a situation worth learning? For example, if I look here, and I see this object, and I look, and I see this this object, and I see particular patterns on the wall, some imperfectnesses on the wall. Are all of these things important for understanding what I am looking for? No. And how we know what important, what is not important? So this algorithm show how the mind, in principle, can recognize what is important and what is not important. So there are here, actually, there are several situations that are similar in terms of few objects, and the rest of the objects are random. And here is how dynamic logic sorts through these situations. Well, you see, it found situations which has several similar objects and combine them together. So these situations, they have how many? Eight or 10 objects that are similar. And because they are similar and they are next to each other, the similar objects appear as white streaks. And here's another situation which has other objects that are similar, etc. So there are several situations which have similar objects, and there is a number of, so to speak, situations which actually are completely meaningless. There are nothing is repeatable from one to another, so really they are like noise. Now, this algorithm requires different type of modification of dynamic logic. Actually, it took me 10 years to move from what I have shown you previously to solving this kind of problem. So here, because the difficulty here was how is it that we know which objects to try to compare between one situation and another. So here this algorithm kind of figured out how to do it. The algorithm turned out to be very simple. mathematically very simple, but psychologically not that simple. Nobody in psychology knows how we understand what are situations. And so what is especially important about this problem is that if you forget about the words, objects, situations, and say that here are some elements of knowledge, and here are more general elements of knowledge. This algorithm then can model the entire hierarchy of our mind. At every level of the hierarchy, our mind moves from more simple ideas to more complex ideas. So at lower level, the mind does find situations as combination of objects. But higher up, simple situations are combined in more abstract situations, and still higher up, and more abstract situations. Like, for example, our mind can combine the concept of rooms in the concept of hotels. Higher up, we can combine ideas of hotels and buildings, etc., into idea of a town or city. So at every of this kind of higher level, our mind moves from simpler ideas to more complex ideas. And it is the same algorithm does it. And I think actually the fact that this is how we recognize objects, that had been experimentally proven, but I shouldn't say that this is how we recognize. More accurately to say is that the mathematical kind of algorithm describing this thing is a good mathematical model for how our mind brain recognizes situation. This is more accurate way to put it. But what I will say now, it is not experimentally proven yet. I think this is the reason, or here is the reason, how come that our part of the brain involved in object recognition, in perception, it is a significant part of our brain, but the part of the brain that is involved in understanding the entire hierarchy above object, abstract concepts, even more abstract concepts, etc., the entire hierarchy occupies probably a small part of the brain. And here I have a suggestion, and I'm challenging now my friends and colleagues in the psychology departments and in brain imaging departments that probably that is the reason why the part of the brain that understands this entire hierarchy of the brain occupies a small part of the brain comparatively to how perception works. The same algorithm from objects higher up, the same algorithm, very simple, is repeated all the time. Whereas the part of the brain that understands images is much more complex, and maybe it is the result of evolution, because when our brain was evolving, probably it didn't know how to solve this kind of problem. And by the way, animals cannot do it. But animals have to recognize objects, and this is why the part of the brain that does perception is much more convoluted and complex than the part of the brain that does the rest of the thinking. But it is at this point, it is just kind of, my imagination, not proven yet. Now, this is figure shows how fast the previous algorithms actually works. It shows, how fast situations are learned. After one iteration, it already has 90% of solution. In three iterations, it finds already all the situations and all objects which are important for every situation. So it's extremely fast. And when I have seen this for the first time, I was amazed how fast such a complicated problem actually is solved.
Yep. Out of it. And you don't know if with one iteration achieving 90%, where do you draw, where is the sense out of this? What iteration tells us that there's sense out of this?
You are absolutely right. There is no sense here. Here, it just, the algorithm just tells you that in these 16,000 examples of combinations of various objects, there are, I don't know, 8 or 10, don't remember, situations which are meaningful in a certain way, that there is something that is repeated from one situation to another. For example, you enter this room and you see right away what's going on here. You ignore patterns on the wall, patterns on the ceiling, patterns on the floor, and you concentrate on what is important for understanding what is here. So this algorithm does the same thing. It's very fast, finds what is similar among very different kind of situations. What each situation means, it doesn't know. You're absolutely right, and I'm glad that you caught me by my hand, of course, so that I will not cheat. Yeah, I'm not cheating. There is no sense is not here. Sense is the next thing. It is actually related to language, and that's why animals cannot do it. And I will come to it maybe in half an hour. I'll come to that. Yeah.
And so that might be why, if you can grow your firsthand experiences, and so that they're very rich, then your brain is better able to choose what is relevant and important and meaningful to your progress in your next experience, right?
Absolutely.
Ability, that's this idea of abstracting.
Yes.
See, I hate the word abstract because people use it in two different ways. I like to use abstracting, meaning you can only pluck a piece out of your experience. Like a scientific abstract is a piece of your scientific manuscript. But other people use it abstract as non-concrete, right? Abstract. And I think that's terribly confusing.
Yep, for absolutely
an
right.
Like myself, when you try to make sense of this. But the other thing I'm thinking about here is this concept, you know, David Bohm's concept of net presentation. So here's my encounter with you. I come to your talk, and I have a preconceived notion that you're of Russian descent. So I have preconceived notions on how this will go. Now, what will my experience be? It will be a combination of my preconceived notions and what I actually take in as far as sense data. What you just taught us here is that memory or concepts are more vague and sensory data are more crisp.
Yep.
Now the question becomes, which is dominant, the vague or the crisp? And I will argue that because the, and I don't know any of this, you're the expert, but I'm listening to you, and I'm growing convinced that the vague dominates.
Absolutely.
Because the brain uses the vague to store memories and concepts. And that's why we're trapped in our preconceived notions. We're easy to fall victim to our preconceived notions. I'll say that Leonid is difficult to understand. That's my preconceived notion. Instead of trying hard to understand you.
Perfect.
Right? And so now the question becomes, how can we train ourselves so that the sensory data, the whatever you want to call it, being in the now, experiencing the now, dominates over the memory?
I think there's actually two different cases these are all the wrong words to try to get the heart of what I'm saying as opposed to fixating on, I know the wrong words. But the vague is dominant in the more abstracted kinds of things. The crisp is going to actually be dominant in the more animal level, survivalistic kinds of things. So your perceptions on the crisp side, right? Your immediate perceptions, for example, if you experience danger, are what you're going to preferentially go with. I see the ball coming at my face. I'm going to duck, even though my vague recollection says that Nerf balls, when they hit me in the face, probably won't hurt me that much. I'm still going to have the instinct to duck. And the importance of that is that it might give you a hint as to how to solve a problem that we just described, which is to be able to shift your thinking to leverage some of that hardwired animal style ability to change how you're going to.
I'll give you a specific example. We do it every day. I have a hypothesis. I love that hypothesis. It's mine. Now I look in the data set. I have a preconceived notion that I'm right, or I wouldn't have done the experiment. So now how do I nudge myself away from immediately looking at something that matches the vagueness of my preconceived notions and concepts, and instead keep looking for crisp things in the now that are actually in the data set, and look from multiple angles? And I don't think we do that enough.
But I think you can do it by bringing about a mindset that puts yourself in a sense of danger. I mean, it's not real danger, but it's a training thing. You train yourself to start looking at that data as if your life depended on it right now, so that you have to look at it from
I think it starts with an awareness that we can fall victim to that sort of thing and get out of your mind.
I agree, David is absolutely right. We only see those things that we expect to see, and we recognize only things which we already have in our mind. To see something else requires Einstein to come and say, look, guys, it is different than what how we thought it is. Greatest to find something that you didn't know exists, that nobody knew exists, it is a very complicated thing and doesn't happen often.
How they train, they get hit to be ready, not to be afraid of being hit, and instead think about finding an opening and hit the other guy. So, I just want to say what Jeff said. I didn't understand if
Let me give you a famous experiment, which might not be famous for among everybody, but it is quite famous in psychology. Three guys are standing across each other and shooting the basketball to each other, just exchange fast ball passes. And a man in gorilla costume is passing inside between them, not on the side, but just through them passing, and they would not notice it, because their mind is preoccupied with other things, and they know that gorilla cannot appear here. So this wouldn't even come to their mind, and later asked, did you notice that there was gorilla coming, was there among you? No. So we cannot see what we don't expect to see. It's very few people can.
But sometimes we can actually do things without we can do things what we expect to do without seeing. I'll give an example. I play soccer, okay? I cannot be as much as I could before. A lot of times what happens, when I want to score a goal, I don't need to look at the goal. It's just I want to do it, and it happens. I somehow get the ball, suddenly run, at some point I kick the ball, I don't know, suddenly what just happened. But a lot of times, I decide, I want to score a goal, and I go close to the goalpost, I look at the goalpost, I kick, the ball doesn't go to the goalpost.
Yep, it is true. A lot of things that we do automatically without coming, consciously thinking about how and what we're doing.
And that's absolutely true. A lot of times it happens with dancers or musicians, they suddenly do something, and that's what they say, that you practice and practice to get to a stage where you and your dance are same, or the samurai say that the spirit of and the sword, if you become the sword is, you're not pulling.
It's Timothy Galway's inner game of tennis.
Yeah.
It's self one and self two. You train, and then what happens is you have to have self one get out of the way of self two. You train as an athlete to hit a tennis ball or a baseball, whatever. You don't want to think about it. You don't want self one to question, no. Oh, now how am I going to swing? Because yep. self two knows how to do it and do it well.
Yep. And the same way our entire hierarchy of our minds operates in the same way. Majority of what we do automatically and not quite consciously about what we do. This is example of application to financial market. One of the our successful predictions.
One quick last thought on what we were just talking about. The thing that you mentioned about expectation is a particularly important piece as well. It is usually the case where you don't have expectation, where you're allowed, where you, it's through not having expectation that you can enhance your ability to use those primordial aspects of your brain in order to experience it. Works very well with infants because they don't have the expectations yet.
Yeah.
But when you can, you know, later in life, if you can meditate those expectations away or whatever it is that you need to do, that can be a channel to opening yourself up to doing what we're just describing here, which is to shift that focus from relying on the vague to relying on the crisp.
So who in here has read Talem's The Black Swan? Right?
Absolutely.
I mean, the idea of being able to predict when that unexpected thing is going to happen. The unexpected thing takes everybody by surprise. How can it take you by less of a surprise? And for me, that that whole book boils down into Taylor saying the concept of tinkering. We're in an age of specialization, and we're in our silos as experts, and we need to tinker. So by growing, by tinkering and growing your experience, you grow your set of possible expectations. Because that's what you were just saying, how important the expectations are. Because if you don't have those possible expectations, you can't see. And it's more important to have plural expectations than a singular expectation. And I think too often we have this singular expectation. That gets us into trouble.
I might comment that's part of the critical thinking thing that I get involved with, is seeking out disconfirming evidence. That is, when you find evidence which is disconfirming, you must accept it because it is a black swan and you are looking for the black swan. You're always looking. And if you are not, you're failing yourself. And as scientists, we're definitely failing because we're not looking at all the other evidence, which just says you're wrong, sorry.